Hello friends, I am Ardhendu De and you are watching Eddie's English Literature. Today we are going to discuss the precursors of Romantic poetry. Precursors means forerunner, and Romantic poetry is the poetry of quite sentiments, emotions, imaginations of that 18th and early 19th century. Now, as you all know, Romantic poetry came as a revolt to neoclassical intellectualism. Gradually, reason and intellect were subdued and it were replaced by imaginations, emotions, passions, humanisms, and much more. And that's Romantic poetry. In between neoclassical and Romantic, there remained a new great writers who might be called harbinger of Romantic ideals. They are the precursors of Romantic poetry. Notably, there are four great poets of that Augustan era. They are James Thomson, William Collins, Thomas Gray, and William Cowper. With the publication of lyrical ballads in 1798, literally the Romantic movement started in England. It opposed the objectivity of neoclassical poetry that I have already told you. Neoclassical poets avoided describing their personal emotions in their poetry, unlike the Romantics. Look at the Dryden, Alexander Pope, or Oliver Goldsmith's poetry, which follows the pattern of that kind of poetry, quite a copy from, or rather derived from, ancient time or Greek and Roman. So classicism is there. So basically they remained busy in ideal forms and dictions. It had been a kind of captivity. In Romantic poetry, such classical reason and intellect were subdued and their place was taken by imaginations, emotions, and passions. Here we will find a kind of interest in the common man and childhood and simplicity. Here is strong senses, emotions, and feelings, and humanism. Here is the awe of nature and celebration of the individualism. Key importance is given to the faculty of imagination, not the faculty of facts. However, the simplicity of diction, love of nature, attachment to human emotions, traits of supernaturalism, which are the basic features of Coleridge and Wordsworth's poetry, can have its trace another 50 years back. In the poetry of James Thomson, William Collins, Thomas Gray, William Cowper, and few other poets, we have the ferment of early Romantics. So our discussion is focusing on these four heads, and we are individually carrying out a discussion and analysis on those poets and how they have chiseled a path on which Romantic poetry went for several years. James Thomson took a deep interest in nature and history in poems like The Seasons and The Castle of Indolence, and for the lyrics, Rural Britannia. His poem The Seasons, which was published in 1730, which includes four poems, Winter, Summer, Spring, and Autumn, evokes an interest in the process of nature. He is fascinated by the fearful aspects of nature, such as floods, storms. He is described as a poet of pictorial landscape. In fact, if we indulge in his poems, we will find a close to romantic description of landscape. He speaks of the interactions between man and nature in the poem, all the four group poems, The Seasons. The four poems in this series are greatly popular and translated in different languages. Even the poem is also remembered for some copyright disputes. The picture that you are looking at is from autumn. In the whole of the seasons, Thomson's style is pompous and contorted, using Milton's blank verse. Thomson seemed to have avoided calling things by their right names and speaking simply, directly, and naturally. So, notable thing is that the great variety and beauty of nature moves him so deep that we can have the Wordsworthian lines in his poems. Reminds us of Wordsworth. Now the soft hour of waking comes for him who lonely loves to seek the distant hills and there converts with nature, there to harmonize his heart and in pathetic song to breathe around the harmony to others, social friends, attuned to happy unison of soul. To those exulting eye, a fairer world of which the vulgar never had a glimpse displays its charms, whose minds are richly fraught with philosophic stores, superior light, and in the oars breath enthusiastic burns virtue, the sons of interest dim romance. Now cold abroad, enjoy the falling day. So these lines are from the season. The section of the poem is summer. So this beautiful illustration proves that point, that the descriptive words that he uses to depict the nature is quite Wordsworthian. William Collins did not write much, but all that he wrote is precious. His first publication was a small volume of poems, including the Persian, later afterwards it was called Oriental. And his principal works that for we are remembering him is his odes. That includes the beautiful Ode to Evening and the Passions, which will live most probably as long as the language survives. Collins' poetry is distinguished by its high imaginative quality and by exquisitely felicitous descriptive phrases, which are close to Romanticism. He exercised pervasive influence on almost all the Romantic poets. Even today, we as teachers and you as students, and so many of us are reading his Ode to Evening, so exquisite descriptive evening description that you will find nowhere. He practically loves nature at twilight. His lyrical odes mark a progression from the Augustan poetry of Alexander Pope's generation towards the imaginative ideal of the Romantic era. His Ode to Evening is the forerunner of Keats to autumn. Romantic tendencies, such as a return to the past and anti-intellectualism, may be noticed in his Ode to Popular Superstitions. Coleridge most impressed, and Collins' use of superstitions and classical legends, he is much praised with that category. Collins' favorite theme of twilight scene, Ode to Evening, is such an exquisite that I cannot resist quoting from that. It says, Now air is hushed, save where the weak-eyed bat with soft shrill seat flits by on leathern wing, or where the beetle winds his small but sullen horn as oft he rises amidst the twilight path. Ends the pilgrim born in heedless harm. Now teach me maid composed to breathe some softened strain, so the lines from this ode to evening is beautiful sonoration of sounds, music, simplicity of diction, and beautiful description of nature. So you cannot miss this kind of poetry in the transitional period here, and you can get the glimpse of early Romanticism here. When we are talking about Grey, one poem pops up, Elegy. Yes, in Grey's well-known poem Elegy, written in a country churchyard, Grey pays attention to nature and humble life, which are dear to romantic poets. Grey was a self-critical writer who published only 13 poems in his lifetime. A very judge of his own poem. Despite being very popular, he never burdened himself with the honors, and he even declined the offer of poet laureate. No poem is such wider acceptance among all the classes of readers than his Elegy in a Country Churchyard. Now fades the glimmering landscape on the side, and all the air a solemn stillness holds, save where the beetle wheels his droning flight, and drowsy, tinkling lull the distant folds. So these are immortal lines from Grey's Elegy. Grey's later writing indicate the swing in the taste towards medieval literature and Scandinavian folklore. The Gothic details that appear in his Elegy and the Bard are a part of the first foreshadowing of the Romantic movement that dominated the early 19th century, when William Wordsworth and the other Lake poets, taught people to value the picturesque, the sublime, and the Gothic. Grey combined traditional forms and poetic diction with new topics and modes of expression, and may be considered as a classically focused precursor of the Romantic revival or Romantic movement. William Cowper is yet another precursor of Romanticism. His signal merits of freshness, simplicity, and graceful humor, and the pure idiomatic expression of English language in which his poems were written gradually obtained recognition, and the fame of the poet began to spread. One of the most popular poets of his time, Cowper changed the directions of the 18th century nature poetry by writing of everyday life and scenes of the English countryside, and that's Romanticism. In many ways, he was one of the forerunners of Romantic poetry. His task, the most notable poem, was published in 1785 and met with immediate and distinguished success. Although not formally or professedly, it was in fact the beginning of an uprising against this classical school of poetry and the founding block of new school in which the coming poets are going to write. In fact, he initiated the journey of nature. As Dr. Stopford Brooke has commented that Cowper is the first of the poets who loves nature entirely for her own sake, and in him the idea of mankind as a whole is fully formed. Samuel Taylor Coleridge called him the best romantic poet. Cowper anticipated the romantic generation in his poetic liberalism, it can be told, in his humanitarian or humanitarianism, and most of all in his sympathetic attitudes towards understanding the human race and faithful rendering of the external nature. Contrasting the rural with the urban scene, he wrote, "God made the country and man the town. What wonder then that health and virtue gives that can alone make sweet the bitter drought that life holds out to all should almost abound and least be threatened in the fields and groves." So this little discussion might have the key idea how gradually Romanticism pops up in English literature. The Romantic movement of the late 18th and early 19th centuries that turned towards nature and the interior world of feelings in opposition to the mannered formalism and disciplined scientific inquiry of the Enlightenment era that preceded it is not sudden but slow and steady progress. You must have to understand that. Lastly, my apology that I might have missed some points in between discussion. You must share your comment regarding this. So like, share and subscribe to my channel. And I need your support to grow this channel. Thanks. Bye-bye.